So everybody else is sitting around relaxing, and after I worked hard for about 50 hours this week, they've got me here at the grill cooking up their chicken for tonight. But that's okay, because I've been promised by Leslie when we go to the retreat that's coming up, I get a chance to relax a little bit. So that's my goal, is to go to the retreat, relax with my wife.
The retreat he's talking about is November 6th, 7th, and 8th at the Wine Country Inn in Palisade. And it is happening after the Mark Gungor seminar. And there'll be two nights at the Wine Country Inn, a wine reception at 5 o'clock, and then the next morning we'll have some ministry time, communion, worship, and just time to be together as a couple.
All right, guys, coming up we have the Mark Gungor seminar, Laugh Your Way to a Better Marriage. And guys, this is one seminar you don't want to miss. I know that's all you can think about, is it's one more seminar. But it's not just one more seminar. If you like the Blue Collar Comedy Tour, you're gonna love Mark. He appeals to guys of all ages. I don't care if they're 16 or 60. Guys, you gotta be there. Not just for married couples. So come on down.
A typical stereotype: men are more interested in sex than their wives. Why would you say that? Because generally it's true. But it's not always true. There are a lot of relationships where the wife is much more interested in sex than her husband. If you're here tonight and your wife is much more interested in sex than you are, I think I speak for all the men here when I say that we hate you.
Good evening. Hey, hi, Bob. All right, Pastor Kirk told me I needed to bring this up. It's a timer. I only have 4 minutes, so time me. Okay, so backpacks. Last year, we got this crazy thing from the school that says, hey, we have some hungry kids. We have 50 kids that need to be fed. Can you help us? We're like, yeah, we can do 50. At the end of the year, we were feeding 680 kids in 8 different schools. And, I mean, you guys are absolutely amazing. And you guys heard the stories about some of these kids. The one about Mark, who went to Nisley, who was in third grade, that was reading at a first grade level. When we started feeding him, by the time the CSAP came around, he was reading at a fourth grade level. And all we did was feed him. The little girl that was out at Clifton Elementary that was living with her grandparents, because both her parents were incarcerated, her grandparents didn't have enough food for them and her, so they didn't feed her. And so she was getting fed every weekend. And, you know, and one of the more miraculous, you know, because we can do things on our own strength, but sometimes we just need the strength of God, amen? And so we were 7 weeks out in March of finishing this backpack program, and we were buying this food to feed these kids, and it's costing us about $1,000 a week. And so we called the food bank, and we said, how much money do we have in our account? And she says, about nothing. And so that sinking feeling kicks in, like, how we have 7 weeks, and it costs us $1,000 a week. How are we ever going to feed these kids? While we're on the phone with the lady from the food bank, all she said, oh, this anonymous donor came in today and gave you $7,025 that God is going to provide for these hungry kids. And so where we're at today is we have 700 kids. Schools are calling us like crazy. Can you help us feed? The school district have 22,000 and some kids enrolled from K to 12. Last year, only about 10% of them were on free lunch or reduced lunch. This year, it's 43%. And so we're with this over-daunting task, because I know that there are many out are hurting right now. And so what we're doing a little bit different is that I know the Lord doesn't want these kids to go hungry, amen? And so last year, what we had you do is we had you go out every week and buy groceries and bring them in to feed a kid. The average cost to those kids, average cost to you is about $30. This year, if we take that $30 that you were spending and we make it to the food bank, if you write a check to the Food Bank of the Rockies, we can feed 3 to 4 kids on $30. And so now we don't have to turn kids away. And so what I'm asking, if you pull out your little bulletin, there's a little tear-off sheet, is that, man, I only got a minute left. Okay, so what I need you to do is, if you can help, $10 a month will feed one child. $20 will feed 2, 3 will feed 30, 4 will feed 40, and or 40 will feed 4. So if you can help with that, tear that off. Check, I can do that. I can write a check to the Food Bank of the Rockies, turn it into the Serve and Eat desk. If you can't, what we also need is, we got to bag all this food, 700 bags every week going out. We need to help bagging things, and this is a great thing for small groups, or if you're new to the church, or you can just help out an hour or two. Our hours are Monday through Wednesday, and then we're also open on Thursday, on Saturday. So if you can come and help bag that up. And then finally, what we desperately need is to be ambassadors to these schools. At the bottom are the 7 schools that we're helping out right now. And right now, like at Nisley Elementary, we have a group of people that go on Monday and Thursday, and they do after-school tutoring. And they help deliver food. And so if you can help do those kind of things, if you want to help be involved in the school, please join us. And there goes my beeper. So tear this off. Bring it to the Serve and Eat desk. If you have any questions, I'll be back there. And God bless you so much. You don't believe the impact you're having on this community. And I'm done.
Let me see that. And, Thomas, go get me one of those almond croissants that I like.
What are you doing?
What is this?
Come on, give it back.
What is it?
Give it back.
It was on the floor. I didn't know it was a state secret.
My freshman philosophy professor assigned this exercise in forward thinking. He called it a bucket list. We were supposed to make a list of all the things we wanted to do in our lives before we...
Kick the bucket.
Yeah.
Cutesy.
Anyway, I wrote down things like make $1 million, first black president, you know, young man's wishes. I was gonna redo the list, but then...
Help a complete stranger for the good. Laugh until I cry. Not to be judgmental, but this is extremely weak.
Well, it's pointless now.
I would argue the exact opposite. All right, that's it.
What are you doing?
A little rewrite, that's all. Drive a Mustang Shelby, not bad. I got one, all right. How about skydiving? Now we're onto something.
We are onto something?
Uh-huh.
Let me see that. Come on.
All right.
Kiss the most beautiful girl in the world? How do you propose doing that?
Volume.
Get a tattoo. Is that the sum of your ambition? Edward, I've taken baths deeper than you.
It's easy to be deep in freshman philosophy. What's Dr. Holland say? We got months, right?
A year, maybe.
You think 45 years went by fast? We could do this. We should do this.
How are y'all? That was a scene from The Bucket List. And it's a very touching movie about two men from completely different backgrounds. Morgan Freeman played a guy by the name of Carter that wasn't able to make it through college because he had to take care of his family, and he was actually very intelligent and was a good father, a moral man. And on the other hand, Jack Nicholson played a guy named Edward that was the complete different opposite, that he was a self-made millionaire, billionaire, and he was crude, he was rude, he was self-indulgent, he was hedonistic. But both of them were brought together by them both coming to the place in their life that they know that they only have a few months to live because cancer had taken over both of their lives. And so they come up together and make a bucket list, the things that they've always dreamed of doing before they kick the bucket. Well, that's the theme of my message this weekend, but it's not our bucket list, but it's Jesus' bucket list for each of us. Now, if you've been coming the last 5 weeks, we went over the five vineyard values. And as our vision statement is to encounter God, others, and the world, we do that through practicing the five vineyard values. The kingdom, theology, and practice, experiencing God, a reconciling community, to have compassionate ministries, and to have a culturally relevant mission. And so that's sort of our bucket list as a church. But now we're moving into the book of Acts. 28 chapters, could take a while. Now some of you are thinking, is he just picking these books out of the air at random? I'll never forget. I don't know why I remember this, but when I was a kid, I was watching Johnny Carson, and he had this little African-American woman by the name of Moms Mabley, and she said, the way that Chinese families name their kids is they grab a handful of silverware, and they throw it up in the air, and when it lands, it goes ching, ping, pong, ting. But there's actually a little more thought into why I'm going into the book of Acts now after we just finished our epic two-year journey through the book of Mark. I went through the book of Mark to get us all acquainted with the theology and the practice of the kingdom of God that Jesus prescribed to us. So now as we go into the book of Acts, I believe that Acts is an important book. After you read the Gospels, that it fills in the gaps historically to help you to have a better picture of the epistles through the rest of the New Testament. The epistles are the letters of guys like Paul and Peter and John. But Acts also gives us a picture of the early church fathers, of what they experienced as the New Testament church began after Jesus ascended into heaven. So I'm going to read now. We're going to jump right in to Acts 1, and we're going to look at Jesus' bucket list for us, all right? In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So when they met together, they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth, even Grand Junction." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." So this is Jesus' bucket list for all of us. He's telling them that before their time is up, here on this earth, here's how to live a life with purpose. Here's how to live a life worth dying for. It's interesting, a British sociologist by the name of Anthony Giddens, I'm sure you've all heard of the dude, but he said, none of us would have anything to live for if we didn't have something worth dying for. Pretty profound thought, isn't it? So the question I want to throw out to all of us is, what have we lived for? What are we living for today? Is our life geared towards something that is truly worth dying for? I think this is a critical question that all of us should be asking ourselves tonight. Some of us may be living to try to obtain the American dream, whatever that is. But in Matthew 6, verse 19, Jesus actually addressed this very thought. And he says, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So what's our treasure? What's the focus of our heart? So the question is, what are treasures in heaven? How do we translate this into our lives today? What would it really look like? And as we go through the book of Acts, we are seeing a historical account of guys like Peter, Paul, and Mary. Well, that's another group. That, like Peter and Paul, that truly lived their lives worth dying for something. But thinking of Peter, Paul, and Mary, some of you younger folks, you don't know who Peter, Paul, and Mary is, do you? Mary Travis died this week. And when I read that, I was actually working on this sermon, and I did think about, I wonder, here's a woman that had all the fame and fortune, and I wonder if she lived a life where she invested in something for eternity. Did she live a life that was worth dying for? I don't know. I don't know all of her story. But this brings us home to us is the question that we can all ask ourselves is, if we died tonight, can we die with the assurance that I lived my life knowing that I invested in eternity, knowing that I lived for something that was truly worth dying for? Did we live our lives with a kingdom of God purpose? Have we invested in things that have eternal value, that will last for eternity? Have our lives truly made an impact and changed the life of another person? That's the question that I think we should leave here with tonight. So here we have the disciples, the 11 that are left because Judas defected. And they've been walking with Jesus for 3 years. They saw him crucified on the cross, and they knew that he was buried in the grave, and then he was resurrected. He even showed them the holes in his hands and his feet. He hung out with them for 40 days. In fact, the scripture actually says that Jesus appeared to over 500 people after his resurrection. And so I tried to imagine, could you imagine being the guys that you were hanging out with Jesus after he was resurrected? I'd be thinking, holy cow, you were dead just days ago. And now you're here with us, and you're eating with us, and this means that everything you've said, Jesus, is the truth. That you told us that you were going to be crucified. You told us that the temple would be rebuilt in 3 days. You were talking about yourself, man. And so I would be thinking, you know what? If it happened to him, he says it's going to happen to us. That when we die, we have hope of being resurrected with him. Now that's faith, isn't it? And I think this is what Paul was talking about in Philippians 3, verse 9. He says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. Why did he always put that in there? Becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. It's critical that we ourselves experience the power of the resurrected Christ. That's why the second vineyard value of experiencing God is so important for us, because when we experience the resurrected Christ in our life, it changes us. It totally changes the equation, doesn't it? Jesus here, he revealed his glory through his suffering, his death on the cross, and his resurrection. We see the glory of a resurrected life. And that's what he's calling us to join in on. So from these first 11 verses of Acts, I believe it kind of sets up the whole book of Acts, of here's what he was calling disciples to, and here's what he's calling us to. In verse 1 of Acts 1, Luke says, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach. Do you hear that? That Jesus began to do and to teach. Got to get those, both of those verbs. Those are verbs, right? Do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. You see, we can't separate what Jesus taught from what he did. It's what we talked about in the book of Mark, that Jesus was proclaiming the kingdom of God, but then he was demonstrating the power of the kingdom through healing the sick, raising the dead, healing the lepers, casting out demons. Jesus had incredible sermons. In fact, if you go back to Matthew 5 through 7, the Sermon on the Mount, most theologians said this is the best sermon ever written. Jesus was truly the best teacher that has ever lived. He was the smartest guy that ever lived because he was God. But Jesus did something like change the water into wine at a wedding in John 2. He delivered a man from multiple demons in Luke 8. And so Jesus, before he was crucified, towards the end of his ministry, he told the disciples in John 14:12, and this is what he's saying to us. He says, I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. So this is part of the mystery, the great plan that God had, is that Jesus would ascend to heaven to enable the Holy Spirit to come and dwell in all his people through faith, and then his people would go and do and teach the things that Jesus prescribed for them to do. You see how the plan, the mystery that was unfolded to the church that Paul talks about? And then when we get involved and engage in the things of the kingdom, that's when we begin to live a life worth dying for. And so the second thing that Jesus calls us to is to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth. I don't know why, but it was God's design, as I just said, to turn over the keys of the kingdom to his disciples, and then to unleash his power through the Spirit and allow the church to take over to be his witness in the world. In Acts 1:8, it says, but you will receive power and the Holy Spirit comes on you and you will be my what? Witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to all the four corners of the earth. Now, if we go back to what the disciples experienced of being with him before his crucifixion and then after his resurrection and hanging out with Jesus, and that their faith was confirmed through that. One theologian wrote, talking about these disciples, their number was so great that it could not be pretended that they were deceived. They had been so intimate with him and his plans that they were qualified to state what his doctrines and purposes were. And there was no motive but conviction of the truth that could induce them to make the sacrifices which they would be required to make in communicating these things to the world. In every respect, therefore, they were qualified to be impartial and competent witnesses. Now, the original word here is martyres, meaning martyrs. So, as the disciples spent these 3 years with Jesus, and then after Jesus ascends into heaven that we just read about, they were utterly, completely, totally committed to live their life for the purpose of being his witnesses in the world. They were all in. They were convinced that Jesus was the Messiah, the Savior of the world, that he was their Lord. They gave their lives to this mission. They literally laid their lives down for this cause because they had an eternal perspective. They knew that if they laid their lives down for Jesus and his mission in this life, they had the promise of a resurrected life, just like they experienced with Jesus being resurrected to them. And they literally were martyred for their faith. The only one of the remaining 11 disciples that wasn't martyred that we know of was John. That John was banished on a prison island for his faith until he died a natural death. So the question is, what gives us the ability to be a witness? Now that's the one thing that we have the great promise of when we talk about a kingdom theology in practice. Is it's more than just us gathering up the unction on our own to say, I'm going to be a witness. I'm just going to go out there. I'm just going to witness to people if it kills me. But some of us, when you think of being a witness, fear starts kind of emerging in our hearts. There's some that would think that, you know, I just don't know enough. I haven't been to seminary. What happens if they ask me? What about the Pygmies in Africa? What if they don't hear the gospel? What happens to them? I don't have any answer to that, so we just don't say anything. Some of us are afraid that, you know, if I decide to really lay my life down to Jesus and be a witness for him, he's going to send me to the jungles of the Amazon where there's no toilets and no air conditioning. Some of us are afraid of experiencing rejection. That we're afraid that if I share my faith with my friends, they're going to think I'm crazy. They're going to think you really have lost it going to that crazy church over there in 24 and a half road. And there might even be some in this room that as I talk about this, you're looking at me going, I've never really considered that I'm supposed to be a witness for Jesus. This is crazy talk. But this is what the scriptures talks about. And first and foremost, if we are going to be his witnesses, love has to be the thing that compels us to do it. Jesus, when he was asked what the greatest commandment was in Matthew 22, 36, Jesus replied, Lord, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. But Jesus didn't stop there. Then he said, and then go and love your neighbor as yourself.